I'm your host, Candice Bar, and we are finally back. I went to Monaco for the Grand Prix for about a week and a half. I'm back. We're back. Obviously not in studio today, but we have a super exciting, awesome guest for today. Like we usually do, we do like our good guests. But before I get to my amazing guest, I have to talk about our Lux Life Inner Circle. We have finally have a Lux Life Inner Circle, the best of the best people in different industries that I know of that we put our Lux Life stamp of approval on for awesome entrepreneurs. So the first one I have to shout out is Miss Tiffany Powers. You can find her at tiffanypowershealing.com. And she is our official Lux Life Inner Circle psychic medium, psychic intuitive. And she's great for personal, business, matters of the heart, whatever issues or problems you may have or questions. Tiffany is amazing. And I can say that to you because I've used her before and she is one of the best of the best. So she is our official Lux Life psychic medium, intuitive business coach. Please contact Tiffany again. TiffanyPowersHealing.com. Then we have our official Lux Life doctor, Dr. Laura Lyle, www.lylewellness.com, L-I-L-E wellness.com. She is a leader in preventative health and anti-aging industry. She is the only dual credentialed compounding pharmacist and anti-aging medical doctor in the world. She is incredibly impressive, really knowledgeable. She's been ahead of her time for a very long time. Again, Dr. Laura Lyle, www.lylewellness.com. I had to shout those two out. So without further ado, we have our amazing guest to Lux Life. We have to introduce Mr. Dan Lok to Lux Life. Welcome.
Thank you, Candice. And who is ready for Lux Life?
Yay! We love a Lux Life. And who better to talk to about that than you?
Thank you. I'm excited to be here.
We're excited to have you. So, you know, you are the king of high ticket sales. Mm. And so, you know, I'm sure that journey did not just happen.
Mm. That's right. That's right. Well, I mean, I always think about what I do. First of all, Candice, not in a million years would I ever imagine this is what I would do.
Right.
Like, as a business, as a career, because my story, I think, started off with just like a lot of immigrants. I immigrated. I was born in Hong Kong. Okay. I immigrated to Vancouver, Canada when I was 14 years old. Mm-hmm. And at the time, just me and my mom, I was the only child in my family. And then my mom and dad, unfortunately, got divorced when I was 16 years old, just after a couple of years coming to Canada. And then shortly after that, my dad actually went bankrupt when I was 17 years old.
Oh, wow.
Because of a business partner, took his money and basically disappeared. And my dad was the one who signed on everything. So that left him about $1 million in debt. Mm. And that wiped him out emotionally, financially. And so as a young guy, as a young man, I had to learn to rely on myself to take care of my family, to make a living. Because right. At the time, my dad in the beginning was sending us some allowance for us to get by on a month-to-month basis, going to school. But then afterwards, because he lost all the money, so just me and my mom and the little bit of savings that we have at the time. And that's how I got into business by accident.
I think most entrepreneurs do.
Yes. Or maybe they got laid off from a job, yeah. Or they quit the job, or they see someone that they're doing something that, hey, I could do that better.
Right.
And got into it. But yeah, I almost got backed up into this whole thing, because the funny thing is, Candice, money and all these things, it never interests me as a young guy. Hmm. Right. At the time, my biggest dream was to actually open up a little martial art dojo in school.
Huh.
That was it. Like that was my like big dream. That's my Lux Life. Like I thought, open up a new school, that's it, right? But because of my mom, that I knew that in order to support her, I couldn't, doing what I do couldn't support my family.
Right.
So I had to make a living. I had to do something else. And that's how I got into business.
Well, this is, I have to ask you this, because every successful entrepreneur I've ever met or interviewed, you know, we do it. We do the action. We have the vision. We have all that. We do that part. But there's always someone or several people throughout our life that has kind of helped us along the way or guided us correctly to our path. So I have to ask you, who was the first person that you can remember in your life to guide you on the right path to where you are today?
Yes, I always say, like, I have read a lot of books. I have like 2,000 books in my library. Like, I have gone to a lot of different training and workshops and things like that. But I am where I am today because of my mentors. Mm-hmm. And I've had two mentors in my life. First, his name is Alan Jacks. And Alan is, I met him when I was in my early 20s. He took me under his wings. I worked for him for about a year for next to nothing, right? And at the time, Alan runs one of the biggest financial education company in Canada. So I was learning from him. I was learning copywriting, like marketing from him for 1 year. And afterwards, I started my own one-man advertising agency as a writer, as a copywriter from my home. So that was my first, a huge turning point for me. Because before Alan, all the business ventures I had tried, they all failed.
Okay.
Right. And I started and failed at 13 businesses.
Wow.
13 businesses.
Wow.
Before having my first quote-unquote success. So Alan was a turning point. Then later on, I met my second mentor who had a huge impact in my life, which is Dan Pena. And you can see it on YouTube. He's known as a $50 billion man. His claim to fame is he grew a company from zero to $450 million in 8 years in the oil industry. So he's a merger acquisition kind of a genius. So he took me on his wings both have been my mentors from over a decade now. So those two men, they changed my life.
Dan, let me ask you, you know, even in the beginning, the two men that you mentioned, how did you choose those guys to be your mentors? Because, you know, there's several mentors, there's several coaches, there's a million people. And if you ask me, half of them shouldn't be coaching or mentoring.
Probably 90% of them. You're being generous. I think 90% of them. Yeah.
I was being nice, but... Yeah. How did you choose them as the correct person for you, knowing that they're going to help you get to where you want to go?
I think, first of all, I want to define the mentor-mentee relationship, because I think people sometimes get confused. Like, say, when you buy, you invest, you go to a workshop, you're going to see someone teach a lecture for 2 days. That's not a mentor-mentee relationship. That's a learning relationship, right? That's fine. And there's a consultant relationship. Example, if I consult with my tax advisor, that's a consulting relationship, right?
Right.
And yet, mentor-mentee, I think it's a very different relationship. I came from a martial art background. I'm a martial artist. So to me, the whole martial art philosophy, now that's a mentor-mentee. It's much more intimate and much more special. Right. It's now, as a mentor, I'm transferring my life skills to you. Right. Some of the most valuable things I learned, not just like a course or like a book. It's something very, very special, like an inner circle. Right. You think about back then, how does knowledge get transferred? Like back in the old day, like martial art, it's closed door, private apprentice. Like, and it takes years. Right.
You're both investing time. Energy,
that's right.
Knowledge. That's right. Value. That's right. To each other.
Yeah, so Dan, I think, first of all, that's the way I see mentor-mentee relationship. And second is, I always believe you want to find someone who's been there and done that.
Yes.
And continues to do it.
Yes.
So not just where, like, because sometimes a lot of, and that's unfortunate. And I think everyone has a right to make a living, but you see, like, social media coaches teaching people who do social media, yet you go to their Facebook, they have, like, 20 people following them, right?
Yes.
Right? You see law of attraction coaches, right?
Yes.
Where they're actually struggling to pay the bills. Like, you have that issue, right? So I always want to consider the source. Always consider
that. That one point today, I had a conversation with someone today about that, and she is a spiritual person, not the one that we have with Lux Life, but she's another spiritual person kind of giving advice on finances. But I know for a fact that she's not doing as well as she's preaching about, which drives me crazy, because I think people are not asking the correct questions for themselves in hiring mentors.
Yeah.
A lot of them are just doing what's popular. And does that person fit you? Because not everyone's made for everybody.
Oh, yeah, I'm glad you brought that up. So, I mean, so that's why sometimes a good mentor for someone may not be a good mentor for you, right?
Yes.
You have to me, a mentor is someone you can resonate with, that your values are aligned, that
yes.
they are where you want to be in your dreams.
Yes.
Like, they're where you want to be. And I like mentors that I can learn from for a long time.
Yeah.
I'll give you a perfect example. Like, when, and throughout like even my martial art journey, when I found out a good instructor, how do I know that instructor is good? Because that's instructor, I could see, wow, I could spend 10 years learning from this person. I don't need to go anywhere.
Yeah.
Awesome. Like, it's the same thing, right? The two mentors, both of being my mentors for over a decade, that is, I'm learning from them. They always give me feedback. And that's what I want. It's not like, oh, it's a 1 month program, or it's like a 2 week course. And that's learning. It's great, but that's not mentorship.
Right. And then we can get off the subject in a second, because I want to ask you, because you definitely know this. When do you feel, or when should someone upgrade their mentor? Like, you know, sometimes a student becomes a teacher, right?
Yes.
When do you then know now it's time for us to move on and kind of part ways?
And I think, like, with my mentor, like the first mentor, Alan, I mean, now he's no longer an active business person, but I think the relationship, the respect is always there. Like, he's my first mentor, right? And then my second mentor, I think, to a point where when you outgrew your mentor, where it could be you feel like, hey, I have learned what I could.
Yeah.
And your mentor would let you know too, right? Like, you know what, a good mentor will let you know you've done very well.
Exactly.
Maybe, and that's the point. Right?
A good mentor will let you know.
Let you know. And then, so now I have my third mentor, which is Mr. Dwayne Clark. And so he's a super successful business person who, like, the values, everything, and someone who are so inspirational. That's like my new mentor that he's been mentoring for the last few months. So like, that's the third stage of kind of my life, right? So I think it's phenomenal. So you would know your mentor, if your mentor is good, your mentor will let you know.
I like that. I got to ask you, kind of rewinding back to your life, when you were, you know, I love how you said you, quote unquote, I don't like the word fail, but you know, the first 13 businesses didn't do as well as you would have liked them to.
Yeah.
And so when you were even starting the first one or two businesses, was your mother or your family around you ever like, what are you doing? Why don't you just do like get a regular job? Like, what's wrong with you?
I mean, so my mom and dad, they're like very, very traditional. So I remember I started my first business when I was in high school, landscaping, right? Landscaping business, mowing lawns. And so when I told my mom, I said, Mom, I'm not going to college. Now, you see the look on her face. like from a traditional, like, Asian family.
Yes.
I just told my mom, Mama just murdered somebody. Like, it's the same look. To her, like, education, like, that's everything. That's why you're in Canada. What's going on, right?
Yeah.
So I told her I'm not going to college. She actually had where she said, okay, son, we're going to talk about it. And then, so we still always remember, Sunday morning, we had we went to a restaurant. We had, like, dim sum, right? A Chinese, like, lunch.
Okay.
Me and 9 other people, which is mom, my relatives, her friends, 9 of them against me, right? All 9 of them trying to convince me why I must finish school.
Wow.
They spent 4 hours trying to convince me. I spent 4 hours telling them why it's not a good idea, then I'm not going to do it. It's interesting. By the end of that, my uncle, who's one of them, actually gave me the initial money to start the next business.
Wow.
Right? So wow. I convinced them. Now, although I lost...
You had to convince like a jury, basically.
Yeah, she's like a jury. and then I lost all my uncle's money. so timing is critical in business. I lost my uncle's money. But that was... I was so... I basically made a promise to my mom. I said, Mom, give me 5 years. I said, I'll drop out of college, right? It's because it's not worth my time. Give me 5 years. 5 years, if I don't make it, I will go back and get my degree and all that. If 5 years I make it, then you let me do what I do.
Yeah.
Right. And I made it within 5 years. Quote unquote, made, like, had my initial success, right?
Right.
So that was, and then my mom could see, even a couple of years, my mom could see that I'm not dropping out of college because I was lazy, because I was driven, right?
Yeah.
I wanted to provide a better life for her. So she could see that. Candice, I was working 12, 14 hours a day, every single day, 5 years. First 5 years. Not a single day off, not one single day off, 5 years straight. So well, my mom couldn't
that.
Prevent.
Let's talk about that real quick. I love that point because I don't think enough people know that is what it takes.
Yep.
When you're building your empire, when you're building your business, that is what it takes. And sometimes it's even longer. Sometimes you're not sleeping for a couple days.
I believe this, that and my mentor talked to me about this long. My mentor one time asked me, he said, Dan, what do you think is the number one quality of a successful entrepreneur? Mm-hmm. And I said, well, you know, you have to have the vision, right? Or you have to have a good idea. I said, nope. You have to have the right people. I said, no. Oh, you got to be great at what you do. No. Oh, is that what is it? So, is that those are all very important qualities. It's not the most important quality. He said the number one quality of a successful entrepreneur is the ability to endure pain for a long period of time.
Oh, I love that. I love that. Yes.
That's it. When no one understands you, when no one supports you, when things couldn't get any worse, can you endure that pain for a long period of time? Not a couple of years, long period of time.
Yes, I love that. Can you tell us the definition one more time?
Yeah, the number one quality of successful entrepreneur is the ability to endure pain for a long period of time.
That is, nothing is more true than that statement.
Because everything else you could get the how-to. You could find the people. You could do all of that. You could sell the product. But that mindset, the tenacity, the grit, that is something that cannot just be taught. You got to experience it, right?
Absolutely. 1,000%. I love that. That's the best thing I've heard all week.
Awesome.
So again, going back to you. So, you know, you started your business in 5 years. You showed your mom that, yes, there is something going on here. And then you had all the other businesses, and then you started with this business that you're currently into right now.
Yes. So, and now we have, like, of course, our companies now, it's a global company. We have a number of companies within this organization with what we do, right?
Well, you have an empire.
Yeah. I don't like to call it an empire because it feels like, I'm like. I think I have a good ecosystem in place.
I like that.
Where I have a lot of, except like we have students now in over 150 countries, right?
Wow. I love that.
From all over the world. And we've worked with, it's amazing. Like even with, in terms of closing, like we now run the largest virtual closer organization in the world.
Wow.
Now, just last document numbers, we have produced, Candice, listen to this, you like this, for companies, like the students that I've trained,
yeah,
over $3.5 billion in revenue for brands and companies. We're closing for Tony Robbins. We're closing for Jay Abraham. We're closing for Harman Brothers, you know, the ones who made a lot of the viral videos. Like we work with some of the best brands in the world.
Wow.
And it's amazing. Like I'm very grateful every day.
I got to ask you, you know, what keeps you going? What keeps you pushing?
I think it changes over the years. Yeah. I think that in life, I believe we go through four stages. The first stage is what I call survival. That's when you're just trying to survive. You're trying to pay the bills, right? And that's what the first stage. That's where I was in my teenage years, right? Trying to survive, trying to make it, trying to pay the rent, right? And I think then after you could do that, you transition into stage two, which is security. Mm. Now you are not survival, but you're comfortable, right? You've got a roof over your head. You've got a good family. Things are like okay,
right?
Security, and then you have what I call third stage is success. Mm. Now, when you're successful, you don't just have everything you need; you have everything you want.
Yes.
Yeah, you don't just drive a car; you drive the car.
Right.
Yeah.
You have several to choose from.
That's right, two to choose from. Or you're not just living in a house, you're living in the house, a dream house, right? This is a lux life, right? This is a lux life.
Right.
And I was operating and living in there stage three for many, many years in my life. Mm. But then what I didn't know is there's actually one more level. Mm. And that is significance.
You know, when people get to this level, because actually not a lot of people do, what then makes you push forward after you hit that success level? I know there's always more, there's always bigger, there's always better. But the fire within, the passion within. I think, as you were saying, it's a different driver from when you first started.
It's a different feel. It's a different feel. 100%. Yes. I can tell you without that, I'm more driven today than I was when I was 21 years old. Because at the time, my dream was just to help my mom, right?
Right.
And once I got there, my dream, just like most young guys, I want to buy us a car, right? Okay, great. You got the car. Right. Okay, I want another car. Okay, you got another car.
Right.
So those are very short-lived. I mean, you know what I mean, right? Once you have to hit that goal, it lasts how long, right?
Seconds.
Right? It's like, oh, get it. Now what? Right? It doesn't last.
You know, it's so funny. I had, I don't know if you know him or not, Jason of Beverly Hills. He's a big diamond dealer around the world. And he actually was saying, he's like, you know, I wanted a Bentley. I got the Bentley. Guess how long I was excited about the Bentley for? The next day, I forgot about it. Like, it's so short-lived.
It's so short-lived. So that's not it. That it's not the answer. But I didn't know.
Right.
I thought chasing the next thing and the next thing and next thing. That, like, it's always the next thing that would give me that, right? But then I realized I am running on the track of achievement, success, trying to win the game of fulfillment. It didn't work.
Right.
There are two different tracks. So when I recognize there's another level, which is significance, then it's no longer about you. When it's no longer about you, it's not me, what I get. When it's about other people, your motive, because motive does matter. Your motive changes. So then you're playing it a game that it's almost like you can never win.
Yes.
But that's what makes it good.
Yeah.
You can always get better. You can always, like, it's just like, okay, maybe it's just through your show, I want to impact 1,000 people. Or maybe in the beginning, you just want to impact 100 people.
Right.
And then I'll impact 100. Then now I want to impact 1,000 people. I want to impact 10,000 people, 20,000 people, 100,000 people. It never ends.
Yeah.
And then I believe that the satisfaction we get, human beings, I think we are wired to help others. I truly believe in that. It's in us.
I agree.
Want to help others.
I agree.
You can, when you can operate at that level, but what's interesting is this, Candice, when you operate at this level, living a life of significance, you get everything else.
Yeah, that's true.
You don't need to worry about survival. You don't have to worry about security. You don't need to worry about success because when I focus on this, my companies are 10 times, 20 times bigger.
Yes.
It's just focusing on me. When now I focus on much bigger mission.
Yes.
And it's funny how it works. Money is a very interesting thing. When you don't chase it, it comes to you.
1,000%.
Right? When you're not thinking about it, it comes to you.
Yes.
Right? It's just like the people who forget about money, are the ones who have money.
Right. And the ones that don't worry about it.
Yeah. Because it's tough not to worry about money when you can't make the next rent payment, right? When you can't make your mortgage payment, when your electricity gets getting turned off, right? It's tough.
Well, I think it's not that you don't worry about it. It's that you don't let it rule you. You don't have an emotional attachment to this because it's not thinking about you. That's for sure.
Yeah. And you don't have to think, you don't need a word about it anymore, right? You have enough. And because I always say you cannot give coming from a place of scarcity, you can only give coming from a place of abundance.
That's right.
Right. So you have to be abundant first, then you can give. It's very difficult to give from a place of scarcity.
I love that. You know, I got to ask you, if you don't mind me asking, every entrepreneur I've ever talked to.
Yes.
We all have whatever faith anyone has or whatever faith you have, but we all have a kind of an inner knowing or an inner connection to something bigger, whatever that is for everyone than themselves.
Yes.
And we could talk a little bit about that for you.
Yes. I think some people, they would refer to it as God, Jesus, universe. But I do think that any successful entrepreneurs, they always have a faith, a spirituality side to them, right?
Yes.
And whatever that you believe in, it's not a religious talk. It's simply, I do believe you have to believe in a higher power. Because you cannot, like, it's funny because if you ask me 10 years ago, you ask me, okay, so in terms of success, what percentage of success you think it's you or what percentage is like other factors? You asked me back then, I was, it's 1% luck and 99% hard work. I would have told you that, like, it's hard work, right?
Right.
Now, I would say it's probably one-third hard work. One-third really it's timing, luck, however you call that, and one-third about the right people.
Mm, I like that.
So I think as an entrepreneur, sometimes we overestimate our abilities or even our importance.
Yes.
Something works. Oh, it's me as the leader, as a CEO. Yes, I think yes, that's part of it. But let's face it: if you build anything significant, it's not you. It's a lot. It's a group effort,
anyone,
right?
I don't know anyone who made it alone. I don't know anyone who's done it alone.
No one. No one does. Right? We play our part as a leader, as a visionary. Right. But there's so many, like maybe you have a mentor, or your mentors, you have partners, you have team, you have like so vendors, you have so many people that help support you. Maybe your banks that support you, right? It's not just you.
Yeah.
We cannot be just, it's all us. So when we kind of take that into consideration, they're like, okay, you know, it teaches how to be humble.
I have two questions for you that are very different that popped up for me. So first question I'm going to ask you is, When you reach that level of success that we're talking about right now, the top level, when did you realize that? Like, when did it really sink in for you? And were you a little nervous about it?
This gets a little bit personal, but I'll share that with you. When I turned 30 years old, one morning I got up in the morning, and tear was coming down my cheek, right? And my wife, Jenny, she looked at me, she's like, what's, because I never cry. Like, she's seen me cry, maybe, like we've been together for 12 years. She's seen me cry maybe once or twice.
Okay.
Like, I'm just not a crying kind of guy. I got in the morning, I was bawling, okay? And Jenny was like, what is going on? She thought, are you sick? Like, are you in pain? Like, do we need to go to the hospital? What is going on? I said, I don't know. I said, I'm just bawling. I couldn't control my tears. And it's like almost like this depression. And I don't get depressed, right? I'm a very optimistic, like, kind of guy. Like, this is very weird.
Right.
And I was bawling, and she was comforting me. And I realized after I had some time to think about it, that somehow when I'm 30 years old, something was missing. Because just like while I was chasing all the success, I thought this is what I wanted. And I sacrificed so much. And suddenly when you wake up one day and say, is this it? Like, I'm 30 years old. I, like, by most people's definition, I'm very successful. Or I've got the lifestyle, the lux life, really, right? But now what?
Right.
There's this void. I don't know how to explain it, but there was this void in me. And I didn't know how to solve it. Because as an entrepreneur, you always say, hey, let's solve the problem. Let's overcome it. Let's conquer the problem.
Give me the problem. Give me the solution.
Boom, boom, boom. Let's get it done, right? Type A personality. And I'm like, I don't know how to solve this. What is this? Right? And that changed my life. And that's when I studied a lot of the spiritual work.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, personal development work. And really learn about myself. I don't want to sound so cliche, but really it's like a discovery journey about myself, right?
Well, it's true.
Yeah. And who I am and what am I about? What do I want to do, right, with my life? And that changed my world view completely, right? And that's when I realized, okay, it's like, okay, Dan, you're smart. You get to this point.
Right.
But what if now you can use your skills, your expertise, what you know, but what if you do something
different,
bigger? Yeah. Not about you. You got you taken care of.
Right. You can check that off.
Yeah, like you got that. You done it. Like, you know, you did all that already, right? You like say you want to travel to Europe. You did that already. Okay, good. Now what else? Right. Can you do it at a bigger scale? Right? Do you have more potential than you think? Right? But instead of just being complacent and comfortable, what else? What more could you do? So how else can you contribute? So that changed my worldview. And that's when I made a switch, transition from success to significance. And from then on, I never looked back.
I love that. Thank you for that. That's a very honest answer. Thank you for that.
Yeah.
My other question I wanted to ask you was, you know, as you were coming up and as you were building, you know, as you're building especially entrepreneurs, as you're building, you're always, not only is business changing, shifting, growing constantly because you're creative,
yes,
but you are changing, shifting, growing constantly, yes, as I feel you should. And yes, so you have to be kind, well, you never really prepare, but you have to be ready for the next level, for you to do the next level.
Yes.
And so in terms of friends or your inner circle or your people around you, when you're building, and friends that are in a circle and people around you now, it does change. Not everyone can hang on.
Most people cannot hang on.
Right.
I mean, show me your friends, I'll show you your future.
Right.
Unfortunately, I have had two friends that I've known for many, many years, over 10 years, that I no longer spend time with because they get uncomfortable.
Right.
They get if you're insecure, or they're always acting more like a victims and things like that. And so, you can try to help them, but chances are it's going to be difficult.
Right.
So you need to upgrade your circle. Like the people I hang around with today, of course, they're very different from when I was. Even today, the people I hang around with today, even 2 years ago, a very different group of people. But right, Candice, as you know, it's lonely at the top.
You know,
it's lonely at the top.
There's a reason for that.
Yeah, it is. And the more successful you become, that becomes the case. And a lot of people, they're afraid of that. Oh, then if I become more successful, I'm going to lose some of my family. I'm going to lose some of my friends and some of those connections. I can tell you, chances are you will.
Yes.
Yeah. Nothing wrong with you.
It's, right.
It's they're not comfortable with seeing you being successful. I know this sounds so counterintuitive.
No, I understand completely. I love this conversation so much because people need to hear it.
Yeah, they're not. Just think about this. Just think about here's what's going on. Imagine your family and friends, like your buddies, high school, all your friends, right? They see other people being successful from a magazine, on social media, on TV. That's one thing. But when they see you becoming successful, someone they grew up with, it makes them feel uncomfortable because it reminds them how much of a failure they are.
Completely true.
And so every time they see you, they're like, oh yeah, you're busy, now you're workaholic, you don't hang out anymore, or this and that, like a lot of negativity.
Yeah.
Because now you are a reminder of what their life could be.
Yes.
And there's no excuse because you guys grew up together.
Yes.
Same town, same city. Like, how come you can do it? I cannot. And it's easy to point fingers at you than looking within, right? So it's not your fault. It's just the way that people are.
And I absolutely love this conversation because I love how you brought up it's lonely at the top, which we've all heard before. And some people, they're like, they have everything going on that like it all checks off that they're going to make it to the top, but there is a moment before you get there. It's a decision of what's important to you, and a lot of it is fear. A lot of people are fearful of being that successful.
Yep. And to talk about fear of success, I think actually fear of success, it's a bigger fear than fear of failure.
Yes. I completely agree.
They don't know, because people know, they know what it's like to fail.
Yeah.
They know what it's like to struggle.
They're used to it.
They struggle every month.
That's right.
But success is like, ooh, it's the fear of the unknown. Like, how am I going to handle it? Could I handle it? Okay, I've never been successful. That's one thing. But if I'm successful, then I lose it all. Then I really look stupid, right?
Yeah.
Like, there's a lot of mental barriers and mental baggage that they have that they're holding them back. So, and that's why when I teach, I always have the mindset component.
Yes.
Always teaching. I'm giving people skill sets, but always combine that with mindset, because I believe we need both. Right.
I love this. This is probably one of the best conversations I've had in a long time.
Thank you. And really, I think like goes back to your question. So I have certain goals, there's certain vision I have for the company, for where I want to go. So the first thing I focus on is not what I need to do. That's a very low level awareness. It's always who do I need to be. So let's say you're running, let's say a six-figure entrepreneur, you want to be a seven-figure entrepreneur. It's not, oh, let me just work more and do more stuff. No. Who do you need to be to run a seven-figure business? What kind of leader do you need to be?
I want to reiterate that. It's not what I need to do. It's who I need to be.
Who do you need to be, right? And what kind of skill sets? What kind of leader do you need to be? Who do you need to hang around with? Who do you need to do business with, right? And then same thing, from seven figure, you want to go to eight figure. It's the same idea. Who do I need to be? Because I could guarantee you the seven figure entrepreneur versus running an eight figure business or a nine figure business, it's a very different thing.
Yeah.
Like who I was running a lifestyle business to running a global company, a completely different thing. Mm. That I could be a lifestyle entrepreneur. I could be a good marketer. Mm. That's it. Now I need to be a good CEO. It's a very different thing. So I need to look at who do I need to be first. Then I go be that person. It's like a little bit people talk about, Dan, I say like fake it till you make it. I'm not saying fake it till you make it. I'm saying fake it till you become it.
Well, I love this too, because a lot of people do fake it till you make it, but they always forget the part where they actually have to make it.
You got to make it. So, right? and I'm talking acting as if you will make decisions. Don't make decisions from here. Make decisions from here.
Yes.
Right? Then this, like I was saying, that don't lower your expectation, right? Knowing your dream, know what you want, and then challenge your, live as if all your dreams have come true, and then challenge your reality to catch up. That's how I operate my whole life. So I always have this first, who I need to be, and then I do that, right?
Absolutely, absolutely. I had a really good question for you that I totally just lost my train of thought. I remember.
Yes.
With all your clients and all the people that you have mentored and helped.
Yes.
I would love to hear a story or two of a client or two that you yourself were amazed by the results. Not that you could help them, but by the extreme change from before when they came to you and after when they were done working with you.
There's so many. Like I have, actually I have a YouTube channel. If you type in like Dan Lok Global Community, that we have like students' stories on there. So many different success stories. You might think
I'm sure there's thousands and thousands, but
yeah, thousands
like really stick in your brain.
You might think that I could name like someone who's like a super entrepreneur that who I've helped, but the ones I always remember, I'll tell you like one that just like recently. Like someone who joined my program and learning how to close on the phone, right? He is 14 years old.
Okay.
14 years old. Okay. Closing like $2,000, $3,000 sale on the phone.
Yes.
Like to me, that's amazing.
I love that.
It blows my mind. And sometimes even story, like small story where a couple joining the program, not so much as learning the skill, how to communicate, but now their relationship gets better because they're better listeners to each other and they know, oh, how come we have that personality clash? Because, oh, we have different personality type. We don't know how to talk to each other. Like little stories. And every single day, like when I log into my Facebook group, I see like every day, just like that makes my day. That's what drives me. Like those stories I love. It's not so much a like one superstar story or grew a company from this to this. I mean, that's all good.
Right. But
these little stories, I love these stories. Because that's who I was when I was getting started, right? It's maybe getting that first sale.
Yeah.
That's great.
Yeah.
Yeah, so it doesn't have to be.
Then you can do it many, 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 many times.
Yeah. Yeah. And because I'm fortunate that I have the skill set to be able to simplify ideas and teach, to be able to do that. I think that's great.
I love it. Fabulous. And so on the other side of that, was there anyone that you've ever worked with that you're like, was there any client you've ever had that you fired?
Oh yeah, many. So many. So many. I fire clients and students all the time.
Wow.
Yeah. Because in fact, I have a very strict policy. Like people, like they join my community. Like, what do you mean you fire students? Trust me. Like, I'll give you a perfect example, because I do a 7-week program called High Ticket Closing, right? Mm-hmm. When we do a week one online, right? Week one, when we have the first class, pretty much by the end of the first class, we always fire some students. Mm-hmm. Guarantee. Mm-hmm. Because we know that's a bad apple. And then we have a no bad apple policy, right? Because we're such a like a big like global community, I'm very protective of my community. So I fire people all the time. Here's what I believe in. You can only be effective by being selective.
Very good.
So a lot of time we take on clients, like, you know what I mean, Candice? You shouldn't take on the client. Like, you know that, yeah, you know, maybe he's going to be a trouble, but you're like, but I kind of want, I need a deal, I need a contract. Yeah. So I'll take it on. Turns out then it's a client from hell.
It always ends up, because I feel like we know our gut, we know.
Trust your gut.
Biting you in the ass.
Always. And those are the clients where you give them a discount, you give them a deal, you go the extra mile, you bend over backwards, and they still complain about it, right?
But you know what, though? I would say for me and my business, I'm sure I'm positive with you. Everything's a learning experience. So it makes you just be like, okay, I'm not dealing with any more crazies. If I know you're crazy before we get started, I'm not dealing with you. Like, we're not doing discounts here. Like, this isn't Walmart. Like, everything makes you get better.
Yeah. And that ties into what I do, the high ticket sales, why I like to do high ticket sales. Because, I mean, there are four types of clients, right? You have what I call cheap clients, which they are driven by price. Mm-hmm. And then you think about quadrant, cheap clients, and then you have what I call difficult clients. Mm-hmm. They're just difficult. They're having a bad day, just trying to make a day worse, right? Then you have what I call sophisticated clients. Mm-hmm. Which they do the research, they understand what they're getting into, they're smart, right? And then affluent clients, which they buy based on emotions, right? Affluent clients rarely buy based on functions.
Yes.
Right? When someone buys a Bentley, you're not buying a car, you're buying prestige, you're buying status, you're buying emotions.
Well, you're buying quality, you're buying experience.
Yes, right? You buy how it's emotions, how it makes you feel. You're not buying for the functionality getting from point A to point B.
Right.
Any car could get you there, right? So it's a very different type of sales and positioning. Mm. And I think as an entrepreneur, we need to decide, okay, you know, do you want to serve this side of the quadrant, right? Are you a Walmart, right? Are you a Mercedes or are you a Rolls Royce?
Right.
You have to kind of choose. And you got to make that decision day one. It's very dangerous to think, okay, because most entrepreneurs will do this, right, Candice? Where, okay, let's say I'm a service provider. I'm going to lower, like, not charge for what I'm worth. I'm gonna go out there, just low ball and get some clients, and later on, then I would increase my price. Now, I use this metaphor, okay? Imagine you want to find a soulmate, okay? Mm-hmm. And you want to find the right spouse. You want to get someone you want to spend your time and get married with. But instead of setting your criteria and expectations, I'm just going to go out there and date a bunch of people. Right?
It happens.
Yeah, and I don't care. Like, I don't care who they are. As long as they can breathe, I'm going to go on a date. Okay? Now, guess what happens to your reputation?
Right?
In the marketplace. It's the same in business.
Mm-hmm.
The how you set the how you create your brand, how you set expectation day one, it's very critical. You can't, like, Hyundai can now sell a price of Mercedes. It's not how it works. So day one, we have to make that decision. And the funny thing is, the way you sell to these customers are very, very different the way they would sell to these customers.
Mm-hmm.
Right? It's a different strategy. So, like, and that's what I want to focus on, because I want to keep my business simple.
I like that.
Right. Like,
I love a great analogy too.
With the you can sell something for a dollar and sell to a million people to hit $1 million, mm-hmm. or you can sell something for $10,000 and you only serve 100 people to get $1 million. Right. So you have to make the decision. Nothing wrong with both models. I'm just saying you got to know which model.
It's also a time factor.
Oh yeah.
And a confidence factor.
Yeah. And what I've learned is it doesn't take you sell something for $1,000 versus $10,000, it doesn't take 10 times more effort to sell something at $10,000. It just doesn't.
That's right.
In some cases, it takes less effort.
That's right.
Right? But it's a mindset shift.
I agree. Mm. Actually, I'm happy you brought up the dating thing, because I was going to segue and ask you into, you know, with business, all the business knowledge that you've acquired, did you use that when finding or dating your wife? Like, how did you know? Because you guys work pretty well together.
Oh, we my wife and I, we've been together 12 years.
Yes.
Right? And we've been married 4 years.
Okay.
And so my wife, she's my best friend, my business partner. She's actually the chief strategy officer in my company, right?
Mm-hmm.
We're 24/7, where we're together every day. And we've been together every day since, like, for like over a decade now. So she works within my company. So when I first met her, she was, because she's 5 years younger than me.
Okay. Right?
So then at first, because she's never dated an entrepreneur before.
Back okay. then. It's an interesting thing to do.
Yeah, like it's like you're weird, right? You're like strange. This is not like, you're not a typical guy, right? But I'm glad that she actually has helped me tremendously in my career, in my business. I'm super smart. And so I think for me at the time, I think the confidence helps.
Yes. Like
being able to have that confidence. But at the same time, sometimes a lot of that, I have to know, example, when I'm working with her, we have a working relationship.
Right.
But when I'm at home, I need to not be a CEO and be the husband.
Right.
I need to wear a different hat. I can't be at home as a husband talking like a CEO and giving orders. That's not good, right?
Yes.
It's like a husband. So we have a very clear like line of, okay, now it's off. We're like husband and wife. You know, we're not going to talk about business and just be together, right?
So I like asking these questions because, you know, for a lot of people, that's challenging.
It's challenging. It is, for sure.
And a lot of them don't tend to get that down. And it can be detrimental to the relationship if they don't correct it and have clear conversations.
Yeah, and I'm fortunate that we're both growth-oriented. So we both want to learn, we want to grow, and we support each other. So we never fight. We don't argue. Right. So then like it's very, very good. And she would give me ideas and I would listen to ideas. And so it's interesting because my relationship with my wife, even back then over the years, like we worked together, but also in a way, her teacher. Because a teacher about like business and people and how it works. And she's of course like grown over the years. In like emotionally, even like just maturity, right? Yeah. How to deal with people. So it's great. Like we have this, like.
I'm sure too, on the opposite side of that, I'm sure she's taught you a little bit as well.
I mean, a lot. She taught me like balance. Like I was a complete workaholic, right?
Yeah.
And so she taught me, no, just chill, relax. Yeah. And I was way more intense back then, right? Mm-hmm. Like it's always this kind of go, like this kind of energy. And she's like, just calm down, mm-hmm. just chill. I'm like, I gotta get it done. Like, so it's like she taught me a lot of that. So she brought a lot of peace and balance and harmony into.
I love that.
My personality, right?
I love that.
Yeah.
Well, Dan, I'm sure you've learned countless lessons along the way, but what are a couple that you still keep in the forefront of your mind that help you to this day that you've learned throughout your years in business?
I would say number one, it is truly about, I believe now 21st century, it's not a war of customers, it's a war of talent.
Mm.
I believe finding good people, keeping good people, that's the name of the game. Mm. And that a lot of entrepreneurs, the problem is, we are type A personality. We get stuff done. Sometimes we are control freaks, right? We want to have a lot of control. That's why we got into business. But when you now want to transition, go to the next level, you have to learn how to delegate and build a very solid team around you, right?
Yeah.
And I'm very fortunate that I've built a very, very solid team. So you would transition. So think about, I would say example from, this is $0 to $1 million in revenue, sales, marketing, offers.
Right.
It's about those three things. Having a solid offer, getting out there, having good marketing and sales, you can close. $0 to $1 million, not a problem, right? From $1 million to $10 million, I would say it's about systems, procedures, right? It is about alliance, right? Those type of things, policies. From 10 to 100 million, culture, leadership, strategic decision-making. Which is a very different things, right? So having that team that like, I'm not doing a day-to-day, I have my team, the executive can do a day-to-day, but I focus on what I do, right? Promoting the brand, it could be like that. Making strategic decisions, strategies, I do that. And finding good people. That like, that's the number one focus, finding good people. So I would say that's like a business perspective, that would be the big thing that I want entrepreneurs to get.
I love that.
Yeah,
I can ask you, is it hard for you to trust?
Very difficult in the beginning.
Yes.
Very, very difficult. Like it was because that's my security, right? Like, oh, like I can make it work. And especially, you know, Candice, when you trust someone and they don't work out, it's like, oh, I knew it. I knew I couldn't trust that person. I knew no one could do it as better as me, right? You know, and then it also, you know, you want something done, you got to do it yourself, right? Well, that what got you here won't get you there.
That's right.
Like the stuff that you need to be able to delegate, like the stuff that I delegate today, like, you know, yeah, my CFO, my, you know, my company, like all the people that you gotta let go of a lot of that. You gotta trust, you gotta empower them.
Yeah. That's right? A good one. Empower.
Yeah. And now I'm very grateful because a lot of the directors and leaders in my company, they could do what they do way better than I could. Mm. Right. Before, maybe I'm the best marketer of the company. Right. No, I don't let them make the marketing decisions. I would look, I would give feedback.
Yeah.
But I'm not the one that's like driving it at all. Mm. Right. So like you have to trust your team. And I think it's very difficult for entrepreneurs, right? But if you want to get to that next level, there's a lot of stuff.
Choice, you have to.
Yeah, there's a lot of stuff you cannot do.
Yeah.
You just cannot, you don't have the time.
Now, moving forward, I could talk to you all day because you're just such an awesome, you have so much value and knowledge. Okay. Moving forward, we're already in the middle of 2019, which I can't believe. Mm. What can we expect to see from you, your company? What's coming up that's exciting for you?
Mm, so like in a couple of months, I'm launching my book. But the book is really to just share my message, right? From a company point of view, closest.com, we're in beta. So we're launching that in about a couple months. Mm. Closest.com, it's very simple. It's where, think about it, it's Uber for closers.
Love it.
Right. So companies can go to the platform and they can find the closers that they need to, because right now the way that companies try to find salespeople, I mean, it's very inefficient. Mm-hmm. They post a job post, 3-4 days, like, you know, 3-4 days, hundreds of applicants, hundreds of interviews. You train them, you hope that they work, and then they don't work. You got to go through this process again. So my vision is very simple. What if you can go to their website, you can click and find someone within hours?
Mm. Amazing.
Right? So, it's, I mean, so that's smart. It changes the game because it's efficient. Right? Just imagine a simple swipe right.
Right? Yeah, it's like Tinder,
but for closers. Right? and instead of like you hire someone and hope that they will work out, what if you know, hey, what if this person, I know this person has closed $2 million in the last 2 years.
Yeah.
And she specializes in digital marketing or she specializes in coaching package. Mm. You can read the profile and you know their track record. Like how much time and money you would save, right?
Awesome.
Yeah, so that's like a big disrupting, like a thing that we're launching a platform, right?
Love it.
Yeah.
So you have the book coming out. You have it's a new website coming out.
Yes.
What, anything else that we need to know about?
I think those are two big things already. Plus, we do a lot of different things, but those are the two, like we say, main projects for this year.
Mm.
Yeah.
So there is one question I must ask before we have to let you go. And I've asked this to every guest I've ever had on the show ever. Mm. And the question is this. Now that you've become quite successful and you are doing quite well and you're helping a lot of people.
Yeah.
What is something that you wanted when you were younger, but you never thought you'd be able to get this? And whenever you got this, and this answer is completely different for everybody. Yeah. Whenever you got this, whatever it is, you took a moment and you were like, you know what? I did good. I'm proud of myself.
Hmm. You don't remember the story I shared with you about my dad that when he went bankrupt, right? So after he went bankrupt, when I was 17 years old, there was a number of years I didn't talk to him because I was angry.
Right.
A lot of resentment because I thought, why did you lose all that money? Why did you divorce mom? Why did you leave me in a foreign country where I don't speak the language? Because I wasn't mature enough, right? Mm. After a few years, my dad and I, we talk again, right? And then now we pair our relationship. Mm. And as I accumulate more wealth and I've been able to do well, I remember one time I was flying back to Hong Kong to see him. Now, you got to understand my dad's a very traditional Chinese dad, like mm-hmm. never shows his emotion, super strict. He's that type of man, right? Mm-hmm. So I was taking him down in Hong Kong. We're walking down the street. I stopped. I said, "Dad, do you see that window up there?" He said, "Yeah, you see that window, right?" I reach into my pocket. I put a key into his hand. His
wow.
hand. I said, "The house is for you."
Wow. Wow.
I've never seen my dad cry. That was the first time. Mm. He, like, tears were coming down. And all he said, he put his shoulders, his hand on my shoulders, just like this. Because he's crying. Mm-hmm. He said, "Son, let's get lunch."
Wow.
That was the best for me.
Wow. That's probably one of the best answers I've ever got, actually.
Thank you. That made everything worthwhile. And he didn't say just to him, just that. Just not
that was enough.
Yeah. And I think he passed away a few years ago, but if you ever had a chance, if you ask him, I think he would say that, like, Dan is successful not because of me, he's successful in spite of me.
Mm. Powerful.
And that would be something that I would be still my proudest moment.
Powerful. Well, we could talk to you all day. You're fabulous, Dan. You're invited back anytime you want. Please let everyone know, if whatever reason they can't find you, I can't understand why they wouldn't be able to find you, but if they can't find you, where could they find you?
Yeah, danlok.com. I'm on Instagram. I'm on YouTube. And my new book, theunlockitbook.com, if they want to get a copy, they could go there as well.
I'm getting a copy. I'm going to give that copy to my guests. Again, you're amazing. Thank you for taking the time to be on Lux Life with us.
Thank you. Thank you, Candice. You're amazing as well. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Evan, for listening and watching. We will see you all again next week. Bye, everybody.